Deeper Insights into the Illuminati Formula by Fritz Springmeier and Cisco Wheeler. Podcast 31. How Help Comes About for Mind Control Victims. Continues. Family, rebuilding a shattered family. Everyone needs to belong to a family. Everyone needs love and acceptance. To belong to a family and to be loved gives a person an identity. The victim's deeper alters have few opportunities for this, unless the support team makes an effort to address these vital needs. When you begin working on a programmed multiple, chances are high that the multiple has experienced extreme inconsistency in the actions of the parents or guardians, and extreme contradictory expectations, often double binds, from the parents too. Most families that multiples come out of are extremely guarded and secret, although they may put on a good front. The good front may simply be an agreed-upon good cover. The multiple's deeper alters have been programmed not to have a regular family, but to only know their cult family or their internal family, other alters. The therapist will have to investigate, who is your family? Name your family. How do you feel about them? The multiple's deeper alters will have to be shown there is an external world. After they were programmed with the no talk, no see, no hear, they were then programmed with the do nothing to hurt the family programming. Why do programmed multiples, or their therapists, sometimes want to contact actual family members? It may be for validation, for justice, for more information, or for reconciliation. First, extended families are poor sources for validation. Second, there is no justice that would be appropriate for the crimes done, such as a lifetime of torture, except an eternity in hell. Forget getting justice. Third, sometimes relatives will provide more information. Generally, victims of mind control attempt to pry information from relatives, and to read between the lines. Worthwhile information can be gleaned from relatives, just realize that it be worth getting it. Often it works the other way. Intense pressure is put upon the victim to protect the family's secrets. Fourth, because most parents of multiples are multiples themselves, all victims of mind control need to be extra cautious about spending unsupervised time with the parent figure. So where does the victim go to rebuild a family? The support team can become the new family. Or the victim can find some brothers and sisters in Christ that are not judgmental and legalistic who will appreciate the victim for all the positives they have, in spite of the multiple's inconsistent behavior. The multiple has quit asking why after about the age of 3 and a half. The Illuminati have built fantasy scripts for them so they don't ask why. The victim only asks why in the context of fantasy. The victim child may explain their parents' multiplicity in magical terms. Child victims will often be aware that they have several daddies and several mommies. They as a multiple will switch to adjust the parental switches. Children may even take advantage of the parents' multiplicity, although it usually works the other way. The therapist may have to intervene to try and spare the child, if the situation warrants it. It makes sense to point out to victims that people have to be accepted in the reality that they exist, and that all the wishful thinking in the world is not going to change them. If we want a good father, rather than destroy ourselves wishing, a victim can find a surrogate father or a spiritual father that has the attributes they feel a father should have. If the surrogate or spiritual father wants the role, that's even better. Rather than beat one's head against a wall that won't change, walk around the wall and get where you want to be. This is not denying the power of prayer. It is simply facing the fact that even Almighty God can't make everyone conform to the image He'd like them to be, because people have free will. Flooding, how to deal with. One of the hardest problems to deal with was flooding with memories. Part of the flooding of memories is the result of a flooding program that is put. The method that is used to program it in is discussed in Volume 2. Flooding is often the result of improper maintenance of the victim's therapy. The therapist wants a controlled release of memories and effects, not a flood that will drown the victim in a sea of overwhelming trauma and emotions. Remember, the amnesia walls were put in by the mind as a survival mechanism. Removing the walls is like removing the dikes of Holland. when the floods come they bring dizziness. All kinds of fears, especially the fear of death, difficult breathing, chest pains, delusions, confusion, chills, and heat flashes, and a terror at losing control over oneself. When memories come, if they can't be processed then they can be stored in a box. Or the memory can be shrunk by the mind to a mote, and then kept small until the mind is strong enough to deal with it. Then it can be enlarged to real life proportions and processed. Another method that works well once alters have learned it, is to place their memories on a screen. The screen can be moved closer, or pushed away. The memory is placed on the screen like a movie. The memory can be slowed down, speeded up, made into a silent movie, made into a black and white movie, freeze-framed, and the sound turned down on it. In other words, the movie screen gives the victim control over their memory, so they can process the trauma, and regain part of their life. The victim can relieve some of the overwhelming nature of the flooding by having someone to talk to, even an understanding friend such as another victim is helpful. Some are able to journal their emotions, or do some physical activity to blunt the effect. Standing up and getting busy, will help place some distance between the alter and the memory. For a small minority of alters they are capable of using prayer, meditation, or scriptures to regain encouragement and calmness. The articles on abreactions may help in this area also. Christian therapists will pray with their clients that memories are released in God's timing and not in a flood. Different programs and memories occur at different trance levels, so the victim can go either below or above the memory to escape an abreaction. Therapists like to encourage victims to remember their cognitive memory, actual event, before their affective memory, emotions attached to the event. It is important to get the entire memory for memory work to be effective, but the alters that can process information logically, but not emotionally, can play an important role in the early processing of powerful painful memories. The emotional front alters are too easily overwhelmed. Many people would like to avoid the pain and have an easy salvation. Unfortunately, the flesh has to be crucified, in a sense, daily, and the victim has to face the reality of what has been done to them. Christ warned his followers that the life of freedom would not be easy. Sometimes victims start pulling up emotional pain without the memories. They may respond by turning to alcohol, compulsive eating, drugs, and sex to escape the pain. Often these escape routes are programmed into them by the programmers. When they start acting this way, they often quit therapy. The therapist might beat the programming to the punch and warn their client that this may happen, so that they don't get discouraged, but realize it is a common side effect or programmed effect of the emotional pain surfacing. Grief. Our Father was also our programmer. As our programmer, He set Himself up as our Savior, our Creator, our God, and our Master. One day during our therapy, Fritz, our co-author, said at a very timely point one of the most powerful things ever said to our system, "Your father had a beautiful little girl, he didn't want a beautiful little girl. He wanted a robotic slave." Those words cut to the marrow of the programming. Those words reverberated down through our system for the next few years. What was stolen from the mind control victim that you are working with? Their identity? Their beauty? Their life? Their honor? Their intelligence? Their humanness? Most slaves never get to the point that they ever realize what was stolen from them. They never get to grieve their losses. The victim has had the truth stolen from them. During therapy they may grieve over this. In therapy, the victim may grieve that their master and programmer was not the image they were programmed to see him in, but was a sadistic person who delighted in cruelly hurting innocent children. The programming for front alters is meant to short-circuit grief. Front alters are to forgive and forget. The therapist can give grief a voice. Grief is not an Illuminati issue. The Illuminati bloodlines have sacrificed humans including their own children for centuries. With such practices there is no room for grief. Illuminati doctrines allow the mind to trivialize death. In our notes we wrote, the circle or web of life is like a Celtic cross looping back upon itself, and intertwined through its own twisting and turning. The continuity of existence is an unbroken chain linking all the elements of the universe. In the web of life, all things share in the same power and can exchange power, life, and consciousness. You will find out in higher Illuminati doctrine that a person's being is considered simply a nucleus, a particle of the vast universe, which creates its own light, and you lose your separateness from the universe. When the mothers of darkness ritually sacrificed a popular queen mother, we'd miss her, but our belief, that she'd left all that she was to the next generation, and that she'd be reincarnated, and that she'd voluntarily given up her life, prevented us from having a deep grieving. We would say things like, "We miss Queen Mother, do you remember when she taught such and such? We must not let that teaching die." We had internalized the Queen Mother to quite an extent through the programming and the cult, so that when she died, it felt like she lived in us. One of our Mother of Darknesses describes further how grief gets swallowed up in the will of life philosophy of the Illuminati. The real or unreal are merely opposite ends of the continuum on which reality can be stretched to include what is normally considered unreal. Even better, the continuum, like a flexible rod, can be bent, curved, and shaped into a circle where the endpoints of reality and unreality met and become the same point. Reality can be demolished then reconstructed, becoming that one part that must maintain a balance, between the internal worlds of oppositional force, unity, and interdependence with all. When something is lost, this philosophy doesn't perceive it as a loss, but a refolding back upon itself of reality. When a person chops up a potato and puts it in a soup, you do not grieve the splitting up and death of the potato, it is joining its life to the eater. When things are taken apart, or die, the particles will reconstruct themselves into the fabric of the universe. Life loops back on itself, linking all elements. There is no loss. Belief in reincarnation and this kind of philosophy eliminate the type of grieving that other people may experience. The Illuminati, and other satanic groups, do not allow grief. It is not an issue that is brought to the surface. But grieving does occur. It is buried in the emptiness of where the altar's hearts have been taken out via hypnotic surgery. Grief lays silent without a voice in the mind and body. Grief lays in the silence of hopelessness and powerlessness. When the cult forces a child to kill another child, many children internally grieve for the child they have been forced to kill. To save the child's soul, you will find that some alters will take on the pain, the characteristics, and even the child's soul and identity as part of their silent grieving process. During programming, grief may display itself as a child in a fetal position, in contrast with an angry child yanking on the cages screaming, or a child crouching in fear. An important key to the success of the programming is the resignation/decomposition of the child victim's mind. Life inherently has fight built into it. The sperm fights to fertilize the egg. The child fights to survive the birthing process. The difference between resignation to a debilitating auto accident and a struggle to survive can mean life or death. The programmer wants to strip the child of this. He wants unconditional surrender of the mind. When the child's mind enters its last struggle for its own life, it is termed decompensation. When the mind quits fighting, and all mechanisms of defense or escape crumble, it is called resignation. A full-blown psychosis results from the breakdown of the personality. Total surrender to overwhelming events is a survival mechanism. The child surrenders to the forces that control it and the new reality and script that are given it. The Illuminati call this breaking reality. The Illuminati programmers want to take the child victim from reality to fantasy. At this point, the child can manipulate his life however he wants to stop the pain. The child has surrendered to fantasy. Does a soldier grieve surrendering to the enemy to save his life? The depth of surrender by the child is so deep, that grief lacks a place in the new mind. The old life has been unconditionally surrendered. Unveiling the breaking reality process to the therapist is important to explain to the therapist why the therapist will not find grief floating around in a system. Instead, the therapist will find happy bird altars, happy singing tree altars, happy bee altars humming and a menagerie of other happy altars content in their fantasy worlds. So where did the grief go? The broken spirit has moved into the fantasy world, and the grief is so profoundly deep and buried internally, so deep that it won't be seen. The grief goes into the dead parts who die, a deep grief so deep that it is death, and these parts end up in the internal graveyards, concentration camps, and other deep burial grounds. The programmers make sure they skim off any dissociative parts that have humanness and grief and bury them. One method to bury the grieving parts is to have Pac-Man altars that eat and internalize these dead parts, come and clean them up. After the Pac-Man altars do their job, they are put to sleep. After the grieving parts are hypnotically buried, only the psychotic fantasy parts are left to build the large altar systems. The programmers want the child slave to look like other children, and the front part of the system may be allowed to have a grieving part. For instance, one grieving altar who held grief kept her tears internal and felt like if she let them out of her bag of tears, which weighed hundreds of pounds, the flood of tears would drown everyone. The therapist may find a grieving part like this. How do you get this part to express the grief that has been kept secret for years? Also, the front parts of a system that hold the body day to day may have the same griefs that other people feel. The host personality needs the support of friends like anyone else, even if the front parts appear very stoic. Perhaps an article Fritz wrote on grief will be helpful to front alters who have grief to work through. The article is meant to be a tool that can be read by anyone to work through their grief. Benefiting from Grief by Fritz Springmeier. Grief, each of us has our own unique trauma to grieve about, and yet there seems to be a great deal in common in the grieving process for everyone. Grief, it is a challenge. It comes with feelings of sadness, guilt, anger, confusion, and fear. The first feelings may be disbelief and confusion. Then we find that we want to get things off of our chest, a release of the feelings. A good friend can really help when we want to talk. Finally, the day comes when we are able to accept what has happened and move on with life. This doesn't mean we no longer care about what we grieved about, nor does it mean we've forgotten, it simply means we have worked through the feelings associated with the grieving process. There is a light at the end of the tunnel, there is hope, there is freedom from emotional pain, but each person has his or her own timetable, and sometimes the journey seems impossibly long. Have you tried to think things through, and it just doesn't happen? Grief is a releasing process, and a healing. The heart and spirit of a person are the players to watch. Don't expect the analytical part of the brain to score a touchdown in this situation. The heart of a person will push through to score, even though the analytical part of the brain schemes. But many of us are afraid of our feelings. We hold back our feelings, when the tears and the grieving are what we need to heal. Blessed are those who weep, for they will find comfort. When we grieve, we often feel our world is falling apart, it's gone. We are isolated in a confusing world. The world made sense, but now it doesn't. Now we see ourselves in such a different world. We need to be patient with the world. Faith is the victory that overcomes such a frightening world. We must have the faith that eventually there will be light at the end of the tunnel. The world that has shattered like a broken mirror seems like it cannot be reconstructed. But miracles do happen every day, and those shattered pieces will miraculously mend themselves in a mysterious way. When we first grieve, many of us want to retreat from life. We find it hard to talk and be around others. We just get through each day. Often we can handle the truth only in small packages, so we turn to denial, either partial or full denial, to get us through. Sometimes the best we can do is incorporate the truth at the speed that we can internally deal with it. We know this happens to other people, but when we grieve it seems to be an aberration. Slowly the mind breaks down its denial. But while it does, we wake up feeling like we're in a nightmare. Can this really have happened? On the one hand we want to disbelieve, yet on the other a small voice tells us yes, this terrible thing did happen. One shock after another. We take the shocks as fast as we can. Someday the denial will be gone, and the grieving will be gone. but until then the process continues. Our feelings of love, our good feelings are responsible for us grieving. If we had no feelings, we could not grieve. Grief is a testimony that we can love. Grief is a neon sign that we can care for others. Grief is a memorial that we can get close to someone. Those same abilities to love are now causes for our pain. The weight on our backs from the grief is really the weight of the proof that we cared for and loved another. When we wrap our world and intertwine our world with another, the world seems empty when that person is gone. The disciples were heartbroken when Jesus left them. The Holy Spirit was sent to be an eternal comforter for mankind. Not only is the Holy Spirit there to comfort us, but many of our brothers and sisters have gone through suffering so that they can minister comfort to us, as they were comforted. Maybe the world isn't so lonely after all. Reaching out to someone else who has suffered the same pain as we have is often soothing. If we let people minister comfort to us, we are giving them the chance to be like God the Holy Spirit, the Comforter. This will strengthen them spiritually as they walk in the same direction that the Holy Comforter moves. Some who we thought suffered with us, may not be in a place to provide comfort. They may not realize that with only a little better grasp of what grief is, a little extra time, and the willingness to listen, they could be so helpful. We must give them space too. But if we reach out for help when we grieve, it is a chance for us to feel needed and loved by the living, rather than staring off into space, and a chance to talk, rather than hoarding our feelings. We must give people the space to not be helpful too. Unfortunately, the type of feelings we are hoarding are often the same type that our friends are secretly denying themselves. They are not able to face true emotions in anyone. The most helpful friends are those who will take the time to find out what we need, and will participate in helping with those needs. A vague suggestion to travel is not going to help as much as if the friend gets a ticket for us and travels somewhere with us. Sometimes while grieving we enter those periods where we need to be touched, to be hugged, to have a pat on the back as a friend passes by. This can mean the world to us. When we grieve, it is natural to feel alone. However, when we grieve, we can honestly come to realize that others have also had the weight of grief on their back. So go ahead and grieve. Grieve and grow stronger through the hours, the days, and the months. The road we each travel is our own, and yet to be honest with life, we each must travel down a road, and each road is filled with things to grieve about. Let us travel down our own road. It is ours to travel. But we must be kind to ourselves if we hope to travel down our own road, because it will take determination and spirit to get through. We must recognize and take care of our needs. If our needs conflict with what others expect, we may have to clearly state our needs without apologizing. It is our own road to travel, not theirs. It's okay to get help from friends. We just need to learn to verbalize what it is that they can specifically do. Vague comments for help during a grieving state may end up frustrating everyone involved. To shut ourselves off from others who can help is not wise. When we grieve, we float through the day. But people are resilient. They don't sink, and after a while the floating numbly through the day becomes soaring and flying through the day. The entire person grieves, the body, and the spirit and the mind. We must minister to all of these. And yet all of these parts seem so numb. Yet, we must allow these parts to feel. The body, spirit, and soul need to express themselves. They need to each groan in their own way. The body feels tired, not just occasionally but most of the time. We must sleep and we must eat if we are to have the strength to continue on this journey. Even if we don't immediately want to do these things, to neglect our sleep or meals will only make the journey harder. On the other hand, we need to be sensitive to our new limitations. Under the stress of grieving, we may not be up to going to the store like we used to, but we can console ourselves with the fact that this will only be temporary. Grief is an emotional surgery to the heart, body, soul, and spirit which needs time to heal. Before our loss, we had settled into life a certain way. When we lose it, our confidence in life is jolted. And that lack of confidence develops into fear. This fear can come from seemingly out of nowhere, and rob us of the safe, secure feelings we had. There are many people who will ask us questions, give flippant advice, and if we let them, they can hurt us. However, we can choose to understand that often their pity is the best they have to offer us, and their questions, however thoughtless, are an outgrowth of their interest and natural curiosity. If people say worthless things to us, then we can discard these words into the trash. We want understanding from others, then we need to give understanding. There are not many people who will nurture us in silence, and just be there silently with us. And sometimes during grieving we want to talk, or to be talked to, but sometimes we just want silent companionship. Grieving is healing. When we lose something externally, sometimes we then try to internalize it. It's as if we are saying, now I'll place it in myself and then I won't lose it. We may adopt the mannerisms of the person we lost, we may in an effort to stop the pain substitute something for them. After we heal, we will still be vulnerable to surprise triggers, which will trigger us to remember our period of grief. First, we must get over our loss, and then we will have to get over the grieving memories. As individuals, we have to wrestle with powers that are greater than us. Changes in life, caused by overpowering uncontrollable events in life, may produce strong feelings of loneliness. If this is equation on life is written in another way, it can also be reduced to the statement loneliness equals a fear of life with its uncontrollable changes. The only way to win against overwhelming situations is to take baby steps and to deal with those situations that we can and keep moving forward even if it's only at a snail's pace. Gradually, as we step through and over the small problems, we will gain the confidence and inner strength to face the bigger ones. Life is brief. Many generations have come and gone. And just as a rainstorm is made up of little raindrops, God Almighty's big plans and His big purpose is produced through each of us tiny drops on the panorama of time. At some point in the recovery phase of grieving, we relearn our own happiness. We salvage what is good in our life, and we recognize how to be happy and we allow ourselves to be happy and move forward. In recovery we find ways to record the past so it is not forgotten, and then turn the focus of our minds onto the present. We cannot be happy in the past or the future, for we live only in the present. It is possible to let go of the past without giving up caring. We can go forward into changes, while our memories carry all that was good of the past that we want to bring with us. Finally, as we recover, we get to the point where we are now equipped to comfort others. As we move forward to help them, we find that in helping them with their grief, we further heal ourselves. What a healing it is when we are able to be thankful for all the wonderful things we have experienced. Some of us have had hard lives, but most of us, there are exceptions, have something that we can appreciate. Thank the good Lord that the earth hasn't jerked as it has revolved around its axis. If it had just once, we might have seriously been hurt. We take so much for granted. Our grief feels like it will rob us of joy forever. Nothing seems to console. We don't think we could ever love anyone in the future, like the people we miss from the past. In the early stages of grief, we were in a fog and it was frightening not being sure how to travel. But we learned to be patient with ourselves, and to balance self-improvement, solitude, and involvement with others. Day by day our emotional lives stabilize. More and more, we bloom like a flower and we open up to the sunshine all around us. We find new sources of love and joy. And as we finally recover, we are amazed at how much grief has silently taught us. We never knew we were so strong. How did we persist in persisting? How did we get past just floating numbly through the day? When we recover, we surprise ourselves at that inner strength and patience we always had but didn't know was there. Finally, the value of choice shines so bright. How wonderful God was in giving us choice. Thanks to grief, we have stopped to reflect upon our lives, and we have realized what is important. The chance to make good choices is important. Now we realize how important. Now we realize that we can choose and design our lives like we choose with the new strengths we discovered through the grieving process. We are survivors, and survivors are strong people. Survivors have better defined goals, fresh views, and stronger views. We have thrown away our masks, and we are facing life with a fresh understanding of who we are. As we grieved, we recognized those things in life which gave us life and strength. Now we appreciate those life-giving things. As recovered survivors, we no longer need to ask why we live. We realize the value of living life to its fullest potential. Now we are ready to be used of God. We are content to be alive. Guilt, dealing with, also see art on self-forgiveness. A. In a deep contrite spirit confess your sins. B. Review the story of the prodigal son. C. Understand how Christ's sacrifice atoned and paid for all guilt. D. Make restoration, restitution, and reparation to those injured. Why have millions, if not billions of dollars, been spent on research into the mind-body interaction and hypnosis? Many believe self-hypnosis is a tool for making changes in your life. Others see hypnosis as a mystical hocus-pocus tool to be misused by people to control others. Part of the reason hypnosis is such a controversial subject is because the powerful elite that control the establishment know it is extremely powerful, that it works, and they want to keep its power out of the hands of the people. Another reason that hypnosis is controversial is that spiritually discerning people have realized that there is a demonic element involved with the process. They realize that hypnosis opens up portals in the mind for demons. This section will attempt to lay out facts, and allow the reader to draw their own conclusions and use whatever techniques that seem to have the best therapeutic potential. Hypnosis is a state of mind in which suggestions are accepted and acted upon more powerfully than they are under normal conditions. The Illuminati rank hypnotic trance depth from 0 to 10, where 0 equals being totally out of the trance state, and 10 equals a comatose state. This scale is called Jacob's ladder. You will find top-notch hypnotists will refer to trance depths as steps. The reader needs to bear in mind that the Illuminati programmers can number the descending trance depths either 1 to 10 or 10 to 1. The choice of which way to number the depths when training an altar depend on several factors. When training a small child, they may be able to count 1 to 10 but may not be able to reverse the count. The programmer may use the count 1 to 10 because it is what the child can count. The programmer may use the 0 to 10 method, as a reversal to what other hypnotists do in the world. The programmers will use one induction method in one area of an altar system and the reverse, or another type, in another area to throw a therapist off track. For those unfamiliar with hypnotic inductions, it is common for psychiatrists/hypnotists to induct people down 10, 9, 8, 7, on down to 1. When bringing the subject up, hypnotists at times actually refer to these levels as steps. In training the child to go down into trance, climbing and descending stairs while counting is used, and the game chutes and ladders is played. The child has often learned to trance as a reflex to the trauma it has received even while in the womb, so the assistant programmers only need to give these already acquired trance states numbers. Under hypnosis, a person can access and control areas of the mind that are normally out of reach of the conscious mind. This also applies to victims of mind control, who can use the trance state to work their way through the amnesic barriers to work with parts of the mind that the conscious mind can't reach. The hypnotic trance is a naturally occurring phenomenon. Most modern Americans walk around in a slight hypnotic trance. The stress of the rat race, television, video games, etc. contribute to the overall trance states that Americans walk around in. Have you ever come into a room full of people who have their eyes wide-eyed glued to the television? They are in a trance state. Have you ever thought about an important problem while driving to work? You were in a trance state. Your mind was operating on two levels at once. The spiritual danger that is inherent in hypnosis is that it opens up the spiritual portals of the mind. The true loving creator of the universe doesn't seek his own, because love doesn't seek its own, but is self-sacrificing. Yahweh God is a gentleman, so to speak, who gently knocks at your door, and wants your conscious mind to voluntarily decide to serve him. The kingdom of demons operates just opposite of this. Demonic entities are always trying to capture the subconscious, to trick the mind, and to force the person into servitude. When the mind relaxes, and lets down its natural barriers to the subconscious, it is an open door for demonic attack. For Illuminati programming, the best hypnotic results occur at about 7. Some people can be hypnotically programmed at 5 to 6, but some children will fight it at that level. Most will cooperate by 7 and everyone else will be cooperative by 8. Beyond 8, the mind and body are in a very dangerous deep trance. It may surprise some to learn that all major programs are put in at the deepest level, level 10. The base level 10 is used for the foundations of every program. Why? Because this level is associated in the mind with the primal functions of life, and the only way this programming can be tampered with is to use drugs and a medical facility which will monitor vital signs the entire time. Once the Illuminati have programmed in the basics to all the programming they want, they will refine and build upon that deep programming at other trance levels. The programming is like an octopus with its head at level 10 and its tentacles reaching up into the lighter trance states. Most alters within a system will learn to stay in the mind at a level 5 trance. The programmers will teach the alters to stay at whatever trance level they want that alter to function at. They want the alter to maintain its trance state. A few strong front alters may operate at a 3 to 4. Since most people are unfamiliar with trances, front alters appear to be normal to the outside world. Most memories of a slave occur at a 3 to 4 trance state. Some memories from deeper may float up to a 4 trance state. The programmers are intimately aware of how memories are connected to trance states, and they have a number of standard tricks to prevent therapists from getting anywhere. One standard hypnotic trick by the programmers is called a trap door. A program or a memory will be placed in at various hypnotic levels. Let's say the programmer places in a memory at a level 4. They will then stop in the middle of what's happening and take the alter, S, down to an 8. The therapist comes along and is getting parts of the memory at 4, and then the alter, S, remembering cannot get anything more because they hit the part that's been put in at an 8. The reverse of this is when the programmer programs various alters that if they hit a certain memory they are to trance deeper, or trance higher depending on what the programmer wants. When the alter reacts as it has been trained, the mind skirts around the memory and never comes to rest where the memory or program lays. These tricks can also be coupled with the use of two opposite induction counting systems, in other words Jacob's ladder get changed. Like moving on a ladder, the mind climbs up or down. Should the therapist decide to use hypnosis with the victim, they should consider using a hypnotic tone of voice that is appropriate to what the victim will respond to. Sometimes hypnotists take control in a military voice as if they are the father figure, and sometimes they are very soothing as if they are the mother figure. In general, the maternal approach works best, although Hollywood and stage hypnotists like the more impressive authoritarian approach. Hypnosis can be related to the unconscious memories of being put to sleep as a child. This is why the programmer or handler will place himself into the role of putting the child victim to sleep. Brahms lullaby is a favorite for hypnotists for inducing a trance. There is a strong tendency in many people to be submissive and to look for a savior figure, a daddy figure to guide them through life. Self-hypnosis has at times lessened the dependence upon the victim for the authority figure that comforted and soothed the victim with his hypnotic voice during the programming. Don't forget that the victim has been trauma-bonded with the hypnotic programmer, and has had a programming experience where drugs and hypnosis were used to give the victim a feeling of blissful, ecstatic merging with the programmer. The alter trusts the programmer totally. The alter will transfer that trust to the therapist, or if taught control over their own trance states learns to transfer power back to themselves. If a mind-controlled slave works toward developing the ability to self-trance so that they can regain power over the slave system, the person will have to overcome several obstacles. the programmers lay in programming to prevent alters from doing their own thing, or allowing other people to hypnotize them. Imagery which uses the senses of smell, touch, hearing, and even taste are powerful for hypnosis. Being able to construct visual images in your head is also a valuable tool of hypnosis. If the therapist and victim decide they want to use self-hypnosis to gain control over the victim's life, such as learning to change negative self-talk into positive self-talk, to overcome fears and anxiety, or to quit a programmed habit, then imagery and visualization will work in the same powerful manner as they did when they were used in a negative way to enslave the person. Finally, there are some victims who will have serious qualms about hypnosis. They object that it smacks too much of being cult-like and that it has demonic side effects. If the victim does not feel comfortable with hypnosis, the therapist needs to respect that. It is quite possible that hypnosis falls into the category of things one doesn't strive to do, but sometimes is needed. In the Old Testament, God didn't want to have to kill his creation with a flood. Indeed, he gives as one of the Ten Commandments, "Thou shalt not kill." And yet, he inspired Solomon to write, "To everything there is a season, a time for every purpose under heaven, a time to be born, and a time to die, a time to plant, and a time to pluck what is planted, a time to kill, and a time to heal, a time to break down, and a time to build up, a time to love, a time to hate, a time of war, and a time of peace." Ecclesiastes 3:1. The ministers who have rejected hypnosis, even self-hypnosis, as a possible tool to help victims of mind control usually have little concept of how much of the victim's splintered dissociative mind lives and operates in trance. We would encourage people to view self-hypnosis as a trance state that is to be used as a means to freedom, not a way of life. As to the objection that the trance state opens one up for demonic attack, so do many other things in life, such as traveling as a missionary to a pagan country. The bottom line is that the missionary opens himself up for attack because he is trying to give life, and the use of hypnosis can only be justified if it is being used in a way that is consistent with giving life and freedom, and life more abundant. Serious unaddressed issues at the deepest hypnotic levels. At the time this is being written, there are millions of people worldwide with end-time programming. This Illuminati mind control programming has been put in at the deepest levels of the mind. The end-time programming concerns those events that are to happen to usher in the reign of the Antichrist. This author is sad that she obediently played a role of helping program this end-time programming into young slaves. What has this to do with hypnosis? Because so far therapists and ministers have only played with the surface issues. Therapists will only deal with issues that clients talk about, and most ministers only deal with surface issues they consider important. There are lots of slaves and Vietnam vets who have programming layered in at the deepest hypnotic levels for the end times, and no one is doing anything about it. End time programming will resemble the following. Some teams will assemble to carry out missions. Sometimes the missions will be one-way missions like the Manchurian Candidate. Some individuals will perform acts of violence and may end up getting themselves killed. Some of the hierarchy systems will go back to the cult and flip their system from being Christian into being day-to-day Satanists. The world will have an anti-Christian fad, where everyone will seem to be turning to the occult and hating Christians. Systems, which have Christian fronts, believe that they can pray and resist the final callback. These type of prayers are similar to praying for someone else. It will still be that other person's choice as to what they do, and in this case, the person's alters, with end-time programming have this programming attached to the primal part of the mind, that part which regulates such things as the heartbeat. Faith overcomes the world, and by extension the new world order. Just as people we pray for still travel directions we don't like, unfortunately alters with end-time programming may well travel directions contrary to our prayers. Still, total faith in an omnipotent God is far better than no faith. The mind of the survivor is like a computer where the operator snaps the mouse on an icon and then shifts into another environment, and continues to move into subsequent areas of programming. Hypnosis could be used as a tool to move down through these monarch mind control computer icons. Although lots of victims of mind control have come into therapists for help, very little work has been done to go down the various computer paths and get into the hidden information that is stored everywhere within an altar system. Deliverance work has been done with a number of victims by a number of Christian therapists, where the Christian therapists were able to use spiritual techniques to break down the walls to get into areas of a system. The co-authors of this book believe that some deep work with end-time programming may need hypnotic drugs and medical supervision, in spite of our experience in seeing some success without going to this extreme. Identity, discovering it. All non-multiple persons as children have ego states that develop and are integrated as time goes on into a more and tighter cohesive package. Most of the lines between the different states disappear after age 1, and the child goes on to develop a single identity. With programmed multiples, the deeper alters, such as spin kittens, will be depersonalized to such an extent that they will have no sense of self. They will also have no sense of reality. Some alters have a 2D world, where time does not exist in their concept of reality. However, deeper kitten alters, for instance, will not even have that. They have been stripped of even a concept of reality. When they hold the body, everything is surreal and clouded by the hypnotic state they exist in. Out-of-body experiences, feelings that everyone else in the world is unreal, thoughts that one is dead are all classified in psychology as depersonalization. A normal Illuminati system will have many parts that are depersonalized. Reality for a spin kitten is but a facade. Can you blame such an alter? Whenever they are used, they receive tremendous abuse in the outside world's reality. It is better that they consider reality to be the walls that they live in along with the internal world they have created for themselves. Reality is being pulled between life and death, and they need to try and find a balance. These deeper depersonalized alters need a new birth into the truth, they need an exodus experience out of their identity as a slave, into a new promised land. This again is why the safety of the slave is essential for progress. Why should a severely traumatized alter, which regularly receives the worst abuse imaginable when they hold the body, want to give up the comfort of their internal world, and come live in the rest of the world's reality if it means more abuse? The children of Israel wanted to go back to Egypt where as slaves they had some certainty. To get a new identity away from slavery is a challenge. There are many parallels that can be drawn between the children of Israel finding their freedom and identity as a people and a group of alters discovering who they are. Sometimes alters can help each other, and sometimes families of alters get into internal feuds. Sometimes a single alter can sabotage the hard work of many alters. Notice how God had Moses give the tribes back their history and ancestry. Soon each person could identify himself as a member of a family that gave him a sense of belonging. Each tribe had a flag. God also insisted that they break from the past. The alter who has lost its identity needs to learn to walk, to feel, to see, to hear beyond the programming. It needs to learn the who, when, where and how of who he or she is. The therapist may say, "You are not a princess," or "You are not a snowy fluffy white kitten. Your identity is your birthright. You're human," that's really where the truth is. It will be hard for such an alter. Everything they thought was real, was fantasy. And reality is extremely painful, so painful that it is beyond words, it is but a deep anguish. But the alter needs to break its old ties to the slave's master, break all soul ties, and unshackle himself or herself from the lies. Then the therapist can teach them their strengths, and they can begin to find some self-respect in who they were when the system was born, and who they are becoming, and who they are as God sees them. Therapists will try to promote the humanism within an alter, by referring to it in human terms, such as saying family of alters rather than the cult's terminology litter of kittens. Doing this may be helpful to the overall cumulative effect of showing alters their humanness, but it doesn't need to be done in a legalistic fashion. Implants, dealing with. The people who are using implants for mind control aren't about to tell us what they are doing, and they certainly haven't obtained the victim's permission for their sadistic behavior. They haven't spent trillions of dollars researching, designing and installing these black budget and secret projects, if they weren't convinced that they work. They are trying hard to get implant technology to the point it is tamper-proof. The controllers seem to think they are above accountability. The various implants aren't the stuff of sci-fi or delusions, their reality can be documented from real sources. Tracking implants are being put into our children and our dogs by people who want to help us not lose anything. Any bozo can purchase human tracking implants today and use them on their fellow man. After you've gotten over your denial that this is happening, you are ready to deal with the unfortunate reality that we live in. The Achilles heel of the NWO is that they have too many things to control and keep track of. This is why they use computers. Computers with artificial intelligence may be able to play chess and make decisions, but they are not superior to the human mind, and you as a human still have a chance to outsmart them. The human, whose mind is being read, can think in codes and speak in codes. The NWO does not have the manpower to control their implant victims with human handlers 100% of the time. Identify who. Thousands of implants victims, and electronic mind control, are looking for help. Some of them have approached the two co-authors for help. Some have given up fighting the implants. Some have bought into the flimsy cover stories that their sentinel handlers try to give them to cover up who is actually controlling them. For instance, implant victims, who obviously have American handlers, are being told that their handlers are Iranians who hate America, or the Japanese who are trying to repay America for Hiroshima, or the Russians, etc. The first step is to recognize who your handlers are. 100% of the implant victims in this country who knew enough clues to provide clues were victims of American organizations. The Germans, the Swedish, the English, the Russians and who knows who else are all putting implants into people. Fritz has lived in several continents and can spot Americanisms immediately. One of the victims which we know, Carol Price, is also aware of Americanisms. The handlers of implant victims in this country have been obviously Americans. So the first step is to recognize that if you are an American, and your problem developed in this country, don't blame aliens, whether from overseas or from outer space. The supposed alien implants in this country that alien abductees keep discovering have continually gotten more sophisticated. The hard fact is that it is our own secret government as part of the NWO, not aliens that are subjecting us to these implants. Now we have identified the basics of the question who. Refer back to the list of abuser organizations in Vol 2 page 18 for a comprehensive list of specifically what organization might be involved. Yes, there is even evidence that groups like Division 5 of the FBI are involved in this type of mind-body control. Also realize that many sentinel implants are being controlled by artificial intelligence in computers most of the time. Try outsmarting the machine by doing unpredictable things. Identify what. If you are an implant victim, begin journaling what is happening to you. Begin sharing your experiences with other people who understand that implants are being used. Go to a spectrum analyzer and find out what signals are being sent. Go to an anechoic chamber and find out where the signals are coming from. Get heat thermography done of your body and find out the locations of implants that way. Map out where the pain occurs. Pinpoint where your master implant is located. Knowledge of what is happening will help you and others fight what they are doing to you. Deactivating implants. Because a variety of implants are being employed by the NWO, there is no set answer to what is going to work. A person is going to have to discover if the implant is metallic, plastic, a virus, carbon-based or whatever. If you can identify how the implant is working, you have a chance to counter it. If you can get yourself to a location where they cannot get signals to and from the master implant, then they will lose track of you. Every few minutes they monitor the exact location of where the victim is. Their tracking computers will soon learn if they have lost track of where you are. That is fine. When they lose track, stay out of their signals long enough to get over 25 miles out of range, and they may lose track of what area you are in. How long you as an implant victim can remain out of their signals depends on where you are willing to go and what you are willing to do. A code activates some of the main implants on a bodysuit of implants. Many have some kind of safety feature to prevent someone from activating them who is a non-approved user. It is speculation at this point, but some of these implants may self-destruct if a person is able to make the implant think it were being tampered with by a non-approved user. If the main implant that controls other implants of a bodysuit is shut down, it might bring a general relief to the victim. For virus implants, there are some antibiotics, some colloidal metals like colloidal silver, and perhaps some juices like cranberry juice that may destroy a virus implant. Certain juices or substances might change the body's chemistry. An implant victim might test several things and see if they can find one that throws the body's system off. For metallic-like implants, there are a few honest surgeons, they are far more rare than anyone would at first imagine, that will take out implants. Although Fritz and I have heard of a number of these surgeons, we do not give out their names. For electronic implants, some victims have blasted their implant, S, with some type of electromagnetic energy to a degree that they blew the implants. Other victims have found some relief from lead shields. The woman who makes lead suits to protect people is Shirley S. Still, 680 West Rose Street, Lebanon, Oregon 97355. The company that produces lead shields using her patent number 5038047 is Shielding Incorporated. International, P.O. Box Z, Madras, Oregon 97741-0069. PH NO 541-475-7211, fax 541-475-6628. Covering oneself. Implant victims have covered themselves with cages of various metallic substances and other things to isolate themselves from the electronic control. The newer implants are nearly impossible to isolate from, but implant victims should certainly try. For fiber optics. Fiber optics are often like hairs. The victim should look for suspicious-looking hair, such as in the pubic area. Better yet, simply shave. Some victims have pulled or shaved off their fiber optic implants. One victim of implants provided this list to search out and destroy implants. 1. Electromagnetic force fields of interference. A. By going to a cable co. and walking around the area of the live satellite dishes. At a safe point, place both hands onto a live satellite dish. B. Try the same at a telephone co. C. To a utility co-electric transfer PT. And walk around the area. If the victim's implants respond to this type of countermeasure, they will experience a pulling sensation, which is a positive sign. Standing near a TV as it is repeatedly turned on and off may create interference with the implants too. 2. Full body electromagnetic scanner. 3. Full body MRI with contrast. 4. Gas chromatography, toxic light chromatography, mass spectrometry, and blood analysis. 5. Mason receivers. 6. Nonlinear detectors. 7. Fergin test. 8. Spectrum analyzers. This victim recommends that if you have a telephone charging device in your home, reprogram it if possible each day, for the telephone can be one of the main power sources of implants. The bigger picture. Most victims of implants need to get the bigger picture. They need to find out what the Illuminati are and who the Illuminati bloodlines are. They need to learn who to trust and who not to trust. They need to learn about trauma-based mind control, because our experience has been that most implant victims are also victims of trauma-based mind control. They need to realize that all phones in this nation are listened to. They need to understand that voice identification programs allow computers to identify who is talking over a phone by your voice. We wish we had all the answers, but we don't. We can report that we have seen some victims get some temporary, short-term, relief from implant control, which gives us hope that if all of us pull together and exchange what we are attempting to do, and what we learn, that we will defeat them. Unfortunately, many implant victims are people who they have identified as isolated and without a support system. Perhaps the first step might be for victims to break their isolation, learn how to be good friends with others, and step out of the corner that the NWO has backed each of them into. Integration, understanding. For years, the goal of therapy has been to integrate the multiple. We believe that a more realistic and advantageous goal would be to allow the victim system to decide upon what form of functional unit they want to be, whether that is a well-organized company, or a close-knit family, or a single identity. The goal is to stabilize and create a functioning person. Everyone, non-multiples included, consist of competing parts in their minds. Even the great Saint Paul, who God used so powerfully, said, "I do that which I don't want to do." Hollywood movies and several popular books have promoted unrealistic expectations that programmed multiples can simply do some integration work and be done. Support people use two words, integration and fusion, to describe various stages of the crumbling of dissociative barriers between alters. At one end of the spectrum is what is called an apparent partial fusion, and at the other end is full integration. Many programmed multiples terminate their therapy before the therapist has much of an idea what the therapist is looking at. Because the front parts of a system are amnesiac to the deeper levels, there have been numerous cases where clients fully believed they were integrated, but the client was unaware of the numerous levels of alters hidden away. Nor will they probably ever detect these levels. Is multiplicity the real problem of programmed slaves, or is their slavery the real problem? The therapists have had a tendency to want to rescue the slave from their multiplicity while not rescuing them from their slavery. The multiplicity is the slave's principal survival mechanism for enduring the slavery. The issues of safety for these did, MPD, slaves are still not being addressed, even after over a century of examination by psychologists on did. Not only do we have problems within did clients, but we have problems within the professional community. Some therapists have decided that multiples are refusing to integrate because they like the attention they get from the therapist, or others, being a multiple. While this may occur, it strikes us as premature for most therapists to judge the victim this way, when they still have such a limited grasp of the programming and the other features of mind control. Most therapists still do not even recognize that there is a world order that is controlled by the abusers. Some counseling courses are teaching their students that multiplicity gives a person a superiority over people who are non-multiples, because it gives them a broader repertoire of actions and abilities. When Fritz took counseling, his college instructor encouraged all would-be counselors to create a pseudo-type of multiplicity. When a multiple system develops a high degree of internal cooperation and communication between various alters and levels, they may feel compelled to hold onto the system's multiplicity because it gives them such a wide amplitude of actions, and makes accountability more difficult. Even though there are distinct advantages, or at least what appear to be distinct advantages, there are times for all programmed multiples when their multiplicity is simply hell. Fusion is generally a process. It is similar to two people getting to know each other's lives. A full integration is when they become one. Is this becoming one like two people marrying, or is it like two bodies/brains actually physically merging? A full integration is the complete merger of the two dissociative parts of the mind. However, much of what is called integration is really more like the marriage of two individuals, and the reader knows that divorces do happen in the external world, and they also happen between alters that integrate in this fashion. The longer the marriage, the more chance for the union. While it is true that as long as there is dissociation left and alters, the network has a foothold to exploit, but another reality is, even if the person integrated fully, the threat that the network could grab the person and manipulate his or her mind still exists. Again, the question must be asked, what is the primary problem, the multiplicity or the slavery? The primary block to integration is programming. And the programming is held in place by demonic entities, lack of safety, dissociation, force of habit, alters who believe they want the programming, and the core splits and the core. While we will not go into the full details of how integration blocking programs are put in, The therapist needs to understand that the client has received lots of heavy programming not to integrate. Trying to integrate doesn't feel like moving to safety, it feels like moving toward death, and if the support team is not careful, trying to integrate alters could easily result in triggered suicide programs actually being acted out. The therapist tells the client in glowing terms how happy they will be to integrate, but the client only feels the death programs that are attached to any thoughts of integration. It seems that therapists could be more discreet and get what they want to accomplish through the back door, rather than tearing down the house trying to get through a booby-trapped front door. One of the best ways is to tell a story, such as Jesus did, and Milton Erickson did, that bypasses the grid of mental resistance and reaches the subconscious heart of a person's thought processes. Creating these kinds of stories allow the therapist to develop his or her own creativity. The stories do not even need to be fiction, they just need to be anecdotes that evoke the subconscious to make the connection to the moral, without the mind's resistance to change being triggered. For instance, there was once a man who found a piece of glass while he was walking. It was so beautiful. Later, he found a gemstone while he was out in the woods. Over a period of time, he found many beautiful things and he put them together in a mosaic. The different colors of the gems worked so well together that they created a masterpiece, for the unified whole was far superior to the beauty of the individual pieces. Internal information, how to get internal information. The great philosophers have encouraged men to know thyself. Self-awareness is easier said than done. It is hard for anyone to crawl into one's own head to see how it works. Our conscious minds reveal precious little about how our conscious thoughts surface from deep in the mind. Whether one is a multiple or not, the mind does a great deal of thinking without thinking about it. Many of the important articles of my second half to this book have been devoted to how to get internal information, for instance, communication issues, fear issues, trust issues, alters, deep, how to work with DA, biography, dream work, hypnosis, self, ins and outs, mapping. The material we have provided on structuring will give many insights into how the Illuminati slave system is set up. As you may know, things begin with the four elements and then are layered outward like an onion. The entire thing fits together like a 3D puzzle. The grid that the handler carries with him will spell out the who, where, what and why of the system. Everything in the system represents something. Simple things can often be important pieces. This article deals with learning how the client's mind works. We'll provide a few more specific insights on how to get internal information, in addition to the above articles. Initially, the client's mind is working on trust. Information will begin flowing once some trust is established. Build the trust first. Initially, the therapist will be trying to establish if the person is a programmed DID. Once that is secure in the therapist's mind, the therapist can begin assisting the client to discover what he cannot find without the aid of the support team about how the client's mind is working. And a giant puzzle begins to be assembled. One of the most difficult things to achieve is a coherent chronology of the person's life. As more and more information is journaled and recorded, the puzzle will piece itself together. Of course, the therapist needs to take good notes, or have an assistant do this. It is often beneficial for the principal alters involved in therapy to see the notes. Another way to do this is to have the sessions tape recorded and let the system go home with the tape and see if they can build upon what was in the session. The slave's mind is programmed to believe that they will die if anything about the internal world is learned or seen. When information is recovered and they survive its recovery, they expose the lie. It will be uncomfortable for alters to go against the programming, but they will soon demonstrate to themselves that they will not be dead the next day for learning about their programming. Assisting the victim to see. Some therapists are having great success teaching primary alters how to do self-hypnosis in order to trance deep. By doing this, alters can go down and retrieve information. Another way to get information is simply to speak through to the subconscious. The therapist wants to make each alter feel relaxed. Altars in deep trance states and deep kitten altars may feel more comfortable with dim lighting. One can't automatically assume that altars will feel most comfortable laying on a couch. Sometimes that feels too close to when they were programmed. Altars should be allowed to choose where they feel most comfortable, on a chair, a couch, or in a corner. They can be allowed to find the place they will feel safest in. Often when the client goes looking, the host altar simply does not see its internal world. During the therapy, there will be a sense that something exists there, but the client will not know how to tag it. You know how you have a nagging thought that you have left something behind, but the description of whatever it was, has not surfaced? Many times all the victim is aware of, is that something seems to be there. To deal with this, the altars can turn lights on, shine the light of the Holy Spirit on things, put windows in, reconfigure mirrors so they can be rotated, or are made from one-way mirrors into two-way mirrors. Then the images that come through two-way mirrors can be enlarged until something comes into view. Many times, with the Alice in Wonderland programming, things behind mirrors are small specks in the grass. Perhaps they see only Mr. Nobody. Like the song, "You're Nobody Called Today," the fact that Mr. Nobody is there is a clue that he is there. Figuring out Mr. Nobody is common sense, he is mentioned just to remind us how things are hidden. Difficulties, pre-existing and created. As a programmed multiple is worked with, they may seem calm on the outside, while all hell is breaking loose on the inside. One of the triggers that therapists often unnecessarily push is that they talk about how the altar is part of the whole. The altars will discover this for themselves. But every time the therapist verbalizes it, they trigger programming, and then various altars get triggered and upset. They feel like their ID is being taken away. They do need to learn that they are part of a whole, but it can be learned quietly over a period of time. The mind will slowly assimilate the reality of it. Occasionally, altars will give a therapist a concocted answer to deflect more questions. Another difficulty is that the therapist and altars will almost always discover the cover story and the cover programming first. There is an art to asking questions to multiples and an art to interpreting the answers. It's okay for the victim to only have pieces. It's okay for the victim to change things as progress is made. Initially, the front altars will be trying to work through a great deal of false memories, planted thoughts, and programming. There is a knowing in the mind, between a planted thought and a real one. This knowing is hard to describe, but part of this knowing is the difference in impact a real trauma memory has in comparison to a false memory attached to a stringer of programming. The false memory will have emotions attached, but the intensity is much less, and these emotions do not linger like the impact of real traumas. After a while, the victim will begin to discern the difference between the real and the false. A standard trauma for children is to lock them in a trunk, and dump the trunk into a body of water where the trunk fills with water, b the child drowns, and c is resuscitated in time to not suffer brain damage. How does the victim's mind remember this? The young child doesn't have a fully developed ability to anticipate. They have been locked in boxes before. From having debriefed children of these traumas, it is manifest that they never remember. The drowning, which takes anticipation, what they remember crystal clear is the terror of being locked in a dark box, which connects with their memories of similar traumas. The emotional affect of this trauma will be dissociated. Another reason why information processing slows down is that information is not processed with its affect, its emotional content. After the therapist asks, "What do you see?" he can ask, "How does this make you feel?" By encouraging the feelings, the memories get worked on rather than being stuffed. When memories get stuffed, then the next layer of memories is harder to reach. At times when a particular area of a system is worked in, the client may feel certain feelings. Why do you feel certain ways when you work on certain areas? And if that feeling is "I'm bad," then rewrite a reverse program, so that each time the altar hears "I'm bad," it hears and thinks "I'm good." The programmers depend upon the mind not wanting to believe itself. when one dissociated part of the mind creates something, the other parts are not in touch with that creation. For instance, parts create their home or environment that they live in. If another part were to try to get in touch with that internal home, it all seems like hearsay, second-hand information. If you were the fourth-born son, you would not remember the first few years of the first-born son's life. It is no different for the fourth split to try to get in touch with the first split's history. It was created afterwards and it has none of the early memories of the first split. The client asks the therapist, "You want me to believe I have rivers? If there are rivers there, then why don't I know?" If the therapist is not careful, the client, unable to see the internal world, may think the therapist is a wee bit crazy. You may get responses such as, "What's a castle? Why would I want to go into a graveyard and dig up old bones? That's scary." Some directions are not in the best interest of the therapy. It is not advisable to get the castle librarian. It is more important not to destabilize the system than any good that would be achieved in this direction. Where to search for information? The multiple's mind will play a mental hide and seek with the therapist. The therapist is looking for holes in which to work through the system. Make a guess, and investigate it with some shrewd test. Try bypassing programming roadblocks with ambiguous statements that the victim's mind has to put into its own context. Much of what we hear in life is ambiguous, except that it is said in some context. Without a given context, the mind has to find one of its own. This is the science of how the mind represents ideas inside its mind. The therapist can gain insights if they will talk to the fear and talk to the anxiety. These emotions may be hiding parts behind them. When a particular alter is having a panic attack, the particular alter may not be able to see the alter with the panic emotions behind it. When you find an alter, main alters may have several roles for the outside world, and several internal jobs. Special purpose fragments, who have no history, are simply parts for a particular job. The therapist can ask questions such as, "What does such and such smell like?" The therapist can talk about their phobias and about their reactions to different foods. If the system has done or will do artwork, and if the therapist will talk long enough about it, then they are likely to get someone pop up who can tell you about it. Questions like, "What do you see in the mind?" encourage the alters to start seeing what is happening in their internal world. Therapists should look for the blue rooms, which are balancing points and a good place to start on each level. The magical room is a room full of gadgets and gadgets. There will be 26 rooms, 2 for each color. Look for the trees, such as, "Do you have any trees in your system?" Ask your mind. One novel way to gain insights into a client would be for the client to give a signed release to the therapist on paper that the therapist can come to the client's house and observe in order to understand better what the client is all about and what the situation is for the client. Another novel way to bypass programming and to give dehumanized alters a sense of who they are is to give their handwriting to a graphoanalyst for a handwriting analysis. Jobs, new ones for alters. During the work on a system, there are different opportunities to encourage alters to step away from their programming and carry out another job, role, or task. Sometimes when the programming has collapsed, it has been appropriate to give alters new garments and new internal jobs. This is also useful in delineating between demonic alter imitations, demonic constructs, and real alters. In cases where the programming has entirely collapsed but the alters are not at a place to integrate, MT schools can be set up for alters to get to know each other and learn new ideas. In terms of working with a particular alter, the therapist can inquire about what the alter's internal job and history is, and what the alter can do besides that. Often the alter will say that there is nothing else he/she is interested in. But if the alter has creativity, the therapist may be able to direct that creativity in a new direction. If the alter is afraid of a particular task, the therapist might be able to use the alter's creativity for he or she to mentally rehearse the job that it fears, where the alter takes control and has a positive outcome. This mental rehearsing may be enough of a calmer for the altar to successfully succeed at the new but feared non-programmed task. If an altar learns a new job, or role, or task, he/she in turn can be an internal team leader to teach things to other altars. He can be the eyes for those altars that still need to learn how to function in the outside world in some task. Deeper altars will have only experienced the outside world in a programmed state. To take the body in an unprogrammed state will be a sharper experience, and the body will feel different. They will need to have their confusion over norms and boundaries clarified. They will have to slowly learn that they can handle a new responsibility. The rest of the altars will watch, and they will have to show that they can earn respect in the way they take on the new responsibility. Justice system, dealing with the broken justice system. The reader is probably not surprised that anyone who has the audacity to write about how to deprogram multiples also has an article on how to deal with the justice system. Writing about the justice system could take a book, and choices of titles might be, How to Ride a Dead Horse, How to Jump into Quicksand, or How to Win by Trial and Error. We really don't have any good advice about justice. In fact, in terms of legal advice, we don't have any except to say stay as far away from legal problems as possible. And most of the readers already knew that. So now that the reader knows that we are all on common ground, or should we say, legal quicksand, we are relieved of any burden to actually accomplish anything in this article, which is about the way you will feel about the legal system once you get involved with its fast-as-molasses process. When dealing with lawyers, it helps to repeat the following mantra, my time is not important. Time is very important for lawyers. Most people have poor methodology when searching for a good lawyer. Looking for a good lawyer is like looking for a good therapist, and if you don't find the former, you may want to find the latter. Since most people have plenty of time on their hands, we suggest that you go down to the courthouse and watch lawyers in action. This is probably the best way to see how your prospective lawyer functions. Lawyers are modern-day gladiators, at least that is what we want them to be. One Supreme Court justice said 50% of the lawyers are incompetent to work in the courts, and the Bar Association defended lawyers by counter-claiming that the figure is only 20% are incompetent. Whatever figure you want to believe in is irrelevant, because the blindfolded lady who was holding the scales disappeared long ago while the lawyers had their backs turned litigating. If you poke and prod a gooey mess on the ground, you will finally figure out what the solution is. We figure that with enough prodding, the reader will finally figure something out. Most of the time, they conclude that the lawyer ripped them off. The lawyer didn't create the mess. Well, maybe they did historically, but your lawyer didn't personally create the mess the judicial system is in. He is just like you, trying to figure out how to ride a dead horse. The only difference is that he gets paid a large fee to do it. You have to watch your lawyer bills. Some lawyers have abnormal calculators. Try to find a lawyer that you can communicate with, and who is honest, and who is on the same wavelength as you. At this point, you're probably feeling that you're in a lot of trouble. And that is the whole point of this, we're in a heap of trouble. The roots of our freedoms are being killed. The Bill of Rights is essentially a dead tree, waiting to be cut up and hauled off. So what are your chances of success with the legal system? I guess we all need to take a hard look at our dead horse, and give it a proper burial, and see if we can substitute a live one into its place. The problem is that the legal system is in the unique position of being granted the power to justify itself legally. If you thought you were going to get an answer on this page, well, we did experientially, you got as much here as you will likely get in the justice system, and it cost a lot less. Now, how's that for a great deal?